This video talks about how to estimate an ArchM model. In my explanations, I do assume that you are familiar with an ArchOne model to model time-varying second moments and ArmorPQ models to model time-varying conditional first moments. But first, you might wonder, why do we need a more complicated model than ArchOne for capturing stochastic volatility? The answer is that if you want to capture the conditional volatility of, for example, the S&P 500, then research has shown that an ArchOne is not sufficient, which brings the ArchM onto the table. So let's start with the basic return decomposition, where the realized return in T is mu T minus 1 plus epsilon T, and the epsilon T is just equivalent to sigma T minus 1 times eta T. Eta T is a white noise process, mu T minus 1 is the conditional forecast of RT, conditional on T minus 1, and epsilon T is the forecast error. Now the ArchM assumes that the conditional variance is a linear function in the past m return shocks. So the next equation formalizes that. So here you see explicitly that sigma square t minus 1 is defined to be alpha 0 plus alpha 1 times epsilon square t minus 1 plus dot 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 plus alpha m times epsilon square t minus m. Now let's look at the ArchM variance parametrization to tease out some intuition. First, the variance of innovations, sigma square t minus 1, rises after large return shocks, epsilon square t minus 1, up to epsilon square t minus m. Second, a rising variance increases the probability that the next return shock is again large. That is because epsilon t has that distribution with a mean of 0 and the variance of sigma square t minus 1. The type of distribution isn't yet specified, remember, because the eta just needs to be IID. Now, that leads to volatility clustering, meaning that if the past periods were rather calm, it's likely that the upcoming period is also calm. But it also means that if past periods were really stormy, then it's likely that the upcoming period is stormy as well. Third, realized return shocks might be small, even though the variance ex ante was high. Now that happens if the realization of the IID shock was close to its zero mean. Last not least, knowing that the variance of the upcoming return innovation is high does not imply that the investor knows the sign of the next shock. For returns, the standard pattern is low predictability in first moments and rather good predictability in second moments. In this video, I will not post nor derive the conditional moments of an ArchM. You can find these in any financial statistics book. Instead, I refer to my video on the ArchOne model, as that reveals the key insights for any type of Arch model. Now, for the rest of the video, I focus on explaining how to estimate any type of ArmorPQ ArchM model. In order to make the explanation more tangible, I assume that we want to fit an ArmorPQ ArchM to a time series of monthly S&P 500 returns. The resulting parametric model for monthly S&P 500 returns reads as follows. So you see RTM equals phi 0 plus phi 1 RMT minus 1 up to phi m RMT minus p, that's the ARP part. Then you have plus theta 1 epsilon t minus 1 up to theta q epsilon t minus q, that's the MA Q part, and then you have the return innovation epsilon t. Epsilon t is simply sigma t minus 1 times eta t, where eta t is the white noise process. And the parameterization for sigma square t minus 1 follows the ArchM structure. So it's a linear function in the past m squared return innovations. Now one can decompose the estimation task into six subtasks. If you understand the six subtasks well, you will notice, of course, that there are several shortcuts that you could take. But as I assume here that you are not familiar with the problem, I'm going to slice the problem into these six subtasks. Let's talk about all these subtasks. First, you fit the armor PQ model to the mean equation. Note, this requires that you first determine the order P and Q, and then that you estimate the necessary coefficients. You can apply the two-pass least squares approach or a maximum likelihood estimation. If you want to refresh these methods, I recommend you revisit the videos on modeling and estimating armor PQ models. Now the second task. Having estimated the mean equation implies that you now have to look at the realized time series of epsilon t shocks. That's what you get out of the estimated mean equation. Now we square the time series, so we have a squared residual time series epsilon square t. And now we're going to test for arch effects in their time series. So for that you can apply the angle 1982 f-test or the portmanteau test. If we find statistical evidence for arch effects, we know that sigma square t minus 1 needs to be time varying and not a constant. So the third task is then we determine the order of the arch effect. For that you can apply the PACF on the squared residuals or the AIC or the BIC test. If you want to refresh these tests, you can revisit the corresponding armor videos. Although here it's applied to arch, the tests and the general procedure are really the same. So I leave that out. Now the fourth task. Once the order M is known for the ArchM, you have to estimate the ArchM parameters with maximum likelihood. For that step, I would recommend you first start to keep the armor PQ coefficients from subtask number 1 as fixed and known. Later, if you're more familiar with the approach, you could directly run a joint maximum likelihood estimation. Joint meaning for the armor parameters and for the arch parameters at the same time. But for now, I assume that the armor PQ parameters are fixed and known, and that RM1 up to RM capital T is the training set of the monthly S&P 500 returns. So your objective is to determine the ArchM parameters alpha 0, alpha 1 up to alpha M, and to recover the maximum likelihood estimate for the variance sigma square T. Now, once we assume that eta t follows a Gaussian 0,1 variable, the joint likelihood function coincides with that following expression. Now, if you look at the expression, you can note that first, the product starts at m plus 1. Second, we divide under the square root by the variance, which is given by the ArchM parameterization. And then e to the minus, we have the prediction error divided by the variance, which also has the ArchM parameterization. Otherwise, the likelihood looks very familiar to you by now. That is due to eta being Gaussian. Okay. Now note that the epsilon squared t time series is now an observed time series of the squared armor PQ residuals. Now, for the numerical optimization of that likelihood function, you better optimize the respective log likelihood function. Conceptually, this means that alpha 0 hat up to alpha hat m are defined to be the arguments that maximize the log of the likelihood. So we can write that explicitly looking at this next equation here, which again looks familiar. It has this Gaussian log likelihood shape. We have minus half log 2 pi, then we have minus half log of the variance, which is the arch M model, and then we have minus half the squared pricing error divided by the variance, which is also having this arch M structure. Now, the fifth step, I recommend that you check that the estimated normalized residuals and their squares are free of serial autocorrelation. For that, you divide the armor PQ residuals by their conditional volatility. So you define epsilon hat t, or epsilon tilde t, you define that to be your estimate for epsilon t divided by your estimate for sigma t minus 1. And you do that for all time periods in your training set. So epsilon t here is the estimated armor return residual, and sigma t minus 1 is the estimated arch M implied conditional vol. So I could also given these epsilon t and sigma the hat notation, since these are the estimates. So according to the model's assumption, epsilon tilde t needs to be IID, right? That should be our proxy now for the eta. It's the return innovation divided by the volatility. So you can apply Leung's box portmanteau test to epsilon tilde t to check whether the return residuals, these normalized residuals, are free of serial correlation. Next, you apply the same test to epsilon tilde square to also check that there is no statistical evidence for remaining arch effects in the return residuals. Now, subtask 6. Assuming these prior tests say that you have really identified the armor PQ arch M structure properly, I recommend you run a final maximum likelihood estimation where you optimize jointly over the armor PQ and the arch parameters. I also recommend you to use the previously determined armor PQ arch M parameters as informed starting values in your numerical optimization routine. Now, the joint log likelihood would read as follows. Phi 0 hat, give them the MLE index to highlight, these are MLE estimates. Phi 1 hat up to phi p hat, and then theta 1 hat up to theta q hat, and now the arch parameters alpha 0 hat up to alpha m hat. These are the parameters that maximize the log likelihood function. Now, here's what the log likelihood function looks like. And you give that to your computer and you find these MLE estimates so that you maximize that likelihood function.